We've talked about using facial points as features, descriptors, indicators whether there's a facial expression or not. As you can see, you can just look at, let's say, the angle here and compare that with the angle here. And they are very useful, they're very powerful, but they can't encode everything. For instance, if you have a little dimpler in the mouth, there's no real movement of the facial points. It's just that this mouth corner is sort of pulling inwards. So you don't get a geometric variation, you do get changes in appearance. It's these kinds of features that we're looking at when we're looking at appearance features. So they're very good at looking at furrows when I frown, and also actually when I smile, the corner of my mouth will look very different from a neutral position. So the question then is, how are we going to encode this appearance? And we want to minimize the variation in our features, in our descriptor, that's caused by things that are irrelevant to expression, such as lighting or identity. And we want to maximize the variation of features that are relevant to facial expression. And in our case, that's quite often edges. So we want to sort of encode edges in a very cheap way. And a very interesting and highly successful feature for that is called the local binary pattern. Local binary pattern looks at 9 pixels at a time. So it looks at a little block of 3 by 3 pixels, and it's particularly interested at the central pixel. So let's say that the pixel value of our central pixel is 8. And it has 8 pixels around it in this 9 block. Let's put in some numbers that make some sense. A local binary pattern is now going to turn this set of 9 by 9 pixels into a single value. And it'll do that by first comparing every neighboring pixel with the central pixel. So this is the intensity value, yeah, or the luminosity value. We're not looking at color, although you could do this in 3 dimensions. But normally people just look at it in grayscale values. So we're going to compare every neighbor of this center pixel with the center. And if it's greater than or equal to the center, we will assign a 1. And if it's smaller than that, we'll assign a 0. So 12 is bigger than 8, so that's a 1. 15 is bigger, 1. 18 is bigger. 3 is smaller than 8, as is 2 and 1. 8 is equal to 8, so that's a 1 again. And 5 is smaller. And then we're going to turn these 8 bits, basically, because they can only have a 1 or a 0 value, we're going to turn those into 1 byte. 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0. As long as we're consistent, we can turn any ordering of these numbers into 1 string of numbers, which we then turn into a decimal number, which we will be using to train our system. The nice thing about these local binary patterns is that it is illumination invariant. If you change the lighting on the scene, all these pixel values will go up, but the relative difference between the pixels will remain the same. 32 will still be bigger than 28. So your binary pattern will remain the same irrespective of illumination variation.
In general, I suppose if that's a shadow line or something.
As long as we're talking about constant, you do get aberrations, you do get difficult situations at the point where you have a cast shadow, but then only at the location of that cast shadow. And because we're usually looking at 3 by 3 pixels, this is not a big problem. Because what we're now going to do is we're going to take our face, and it's our big smiley face. I think I'd be better in drawing faces by now after 10 years of working in this area, but I'm not. We're going to divide this area into a number of blocks. At the moment I'm choosing 4 by 4. And this local binary pattern, it's centered on a single pixel and then compares with its neighbors. So basically, we have to do this for every pixel in this block, and each of those will result in a different decimal number. For this block here, we might get values of 2, 3, 4, 2, 8, 8, 13, 12, etc. And if there's enough pixels in that block, if the block is big enough, we will actually turn these values into a histogram. So basically looking at the statistics, how many times did 13 come up? How many times did 12 come up? And because there's only 256 different values in this block, you actually get quite robust statistics. In practice, we use something what's called uniform local binary patterns, and they only have 59 different possible values rather than 256, so you get really quite robust statistics. The other thing that local binary patterns encode is edges. As I said, we're interested in edge detectors, in the edges that sort of show you the outline of the mouth or the eyelid. And as you can see, here you've got three ones, then a set of zeros, a one and a zero. Basically, what that means is that you have a transition here from a one to a zero, and you've got a transition here from a zero to one, from one to zero again, and from zero to one. Those transitions are edges. So we now very clearly indicate where you've got a transition from a light area in the face to a dark area in the face, which is exactly what an edge is. So we've turned a possibly very high dimensional space that was based purely on pixel intensities into a low dimensional space that only encodes relative intensity values, and in doing so encodes edges. So we now have got an illumination invariant descriptor of edges. When you think about it, facial expression recognition is actually action detection. You're not necessarily, you're not really interested in the static smile. You're interested in the fact that I'm, you know, went from a neutral face to smiling. So you're looking at differences. You're looking at actions, movements. And all these descriptors, the appearance descriptors, they only describe the edges in one frame. It's static. So what you really want to do is you want to see how these pixels change over time. One way of doing that is you could actually extend this block to become a cube, and you would get comparisons between the center of that cube somewhere down there and all its neighbors. You would have 2 to the power of 26 different possible byte values.
And that's just saying that as it goes back into 3D, that's time kicking in, is it?
So exactly. So if we're now going to look at, not at a single frame, but at a set of frames, let's say 3 frames. So then this is our Y direction. This is our X direction. This is just our horizontal and vertical space. It's just a normal image. And then this is time. Basically saying that this is the first frame, that's the second frame, and that's your third frame. And you can now look at the differences, not just within one frame between the central pixel, but also the difference between this pixel and the pixel at the same location in the next frame, or the pixel in the next frame, but a little bit up. You should get a cube of pixels around this central pixel. 9 in front, 9 in back, and 8 surrounding it in the current frame. That's a total of 26 different neighbors. So you get 2 to the power of 26 different possible values. And that's a lot. Instead, you can do a little trick. So you can say, I'm still interested in the changes over time, but I might not be interested in just every possible change. I just want to look at 3 orthogonal planes, as it's called. The first orthogonal plane, of course, being just the XY, your normal image. And then you take a slice through X and T, so that's a horizontal slice, and you take a slice through the vertical and time, so that's a vertical slice. There, that one is orthogonal to the X and T, and of course it's orthogonal to the normal XY plane. So that's why it's called 3 orthogonal planes. And each of them now encodes either edges in space, in just your normal 2D image, or an edge in X and time, or an edge in Y and time. And if you do this, you get 3 times 2 to the power of 8 solutions, which is a lot smaller than 2 to the power of 26. And you still perfectly encode movements, actions of edges over time. And if you do this, you will get significant performance increases. So all the legal patterns get their own code, and all the illegal patterns get mashed together into the 59th.